All right, ladies and gentlemen, well, good evening and welcome to this beautiful venue that we have here in the sports pavilion. And apologies for not being in the council offices, but as you know, they've been renovated at the moment for good reason. So we'll get on with our meeting here tonight, and I think it's going to be here next month, too, Charlie?
No.
Mount Beauty next month. That's right, I've got my ring on after. So we'll move on with the meeting. We're going to have to use the microphones tonight. Once question time is finished, I'll grab that one there and we can share that one amongst the councillors and staff. I'll hand it over for item one to the CEO.
All council meetings are filmed with both video and audio being recorded. Video is focused on a specific area, however audio from the entire room is captured. By speaking during question time or any time during the meeting, you can send to your voice any comments you make being recorded. In Commonwealth narrative during council meetings, verbal responses to the congratulations, obituaries and question time will not be recorded in the written minutes. The reason behind recording council meetings is of course to hold us more accountable and improve the transparency of council's decision making to our community. The full meeting is being recorded and a copy will be uploaded to council's YouTube channel, which is Outline Shire Council, and will also be available on the YouTube channel shortly after this meeting. The Outline Shire Council acknowledges the traditional owners of the land we're now on. We also acknowledge those people who have contributed to the rich fabric of our community and strive to make wise decisions that will improve the quality of life.
Thank you, and as it is remembrance of the 2009 Victoria bushfires, note that we're wearing the yellow ribbons to acknowledge and pay respect to the victims of the bushfires. Council recognises the 10-year anniversary of the 2009 Victoria bushfires on Thursday the 7th of February. These fires are one of the most significant natural disasters Victoria has experienced, and memories of the event still impact communities to this day. While this is a time to look back and remember those who have lost, it is also an opportunity to celebrate how far communities have come, their strength and resilience in the face of adversity. So in respect of that, I ask that we have 1 minute silence. Thank you. Item 4, 5, obituaries and congratulations from my work, Councillor Pearce.
Yes.
Councillor Nicholas.
Just congratulations to all those who were awarded Australia Day honours by the Melbourne Shire and by the government.
Thank you. I have a couple of items in the obituary for Myrtleford. Rosa Sacco, she commenced employment with the Alpine Shire Council in 1991 and held the important job of school crossing supervisor in Myrtleford for a number of years. Rosa had a short battle with cancer and passed away on the 20th of December 2018, and Council sends its condolences to her husband Joe, Angelo and Paul, her children. Congratulations also to the Medal of the Order of Australia in the General Division to Mr. Frederick Martin from Toowoomba South for service to the community. He's a media presenter, 9 years Adelaide, 1996 to 2007. Author, Keith Martin's South Australia Almanac, 1985-2007. Presenter, Channel 7 Adelaide, 1980-1996. Rural Affairs Officer, ABC Radio Darwin, 1965-1970. Radio presenter, ABC Radio South Australia, 1964-65. So I've got 2 years. Tones on local radio?
No.
There's one for you to get hold of, Mary. Any other condolences or obituaries against the Roper or as much time? None. Thank you. Declarations, item 6, declarations by councillors of conflict of interest. There are nil. Public questions, item 7. Questions on matters limited to two questions per person. And we have some questions from the floor as well, I'm sure we will. Other than what we have to consumption of alcohol in public places. So if no council decision has been made, it's simply out there for comment from members of the public. But also we are working and refer to evidence-based information that we have from dealing with the medical profession, community groups, etc. And we need to take that all into consideration for the great good of our whole community. And I certainly understand that there is angst or concern that, you know, we're just going to stop all fun, we're going to be anti-fun people, or it's going to be an anti-fun council, but I don't, that is not the intent of any proposed change to our local laws. But I'll let Ms Cook summarise the response as well.
Thank you, Mr Mayor. Our Hampshire Council's Municipal Health and Wellbeing 2017 to 2021 action plan, so you might have seen that that's appended as part of our council plan in 2017, includes an action to review our local law regarding the consumption of alcohol in public places. So this proposed local law addresses this action, but as a result of a large body of evidence on alcohol-related harm in our community. The role of public drinking plays in normalising consumption of alcohol is well documented, particularly for children. The normalisation of drinking and influence to children particularly. So council does recognise that restricting the consumption of alcohol is a small, but it's a significant step towards this goal of reviewing our local law and our views on drinking in public places, but it won't stop the effects of alcohol and harm in our community. Not on its own. With regard to the second part of the question, Council's draft community local law is actually a really significant simplification of our current local laws numbers 2 to 7. It brings our current suite of local laws into one local law. We anticipate that it will actually give us a significant improvement in efficiency with regards to compliance in particular. A large amount of the duplication that we've had across those local laws have been removed. For example, and in particular the one that's been brought up, which I'll address, where we are able to address issues under different acts, for example, the Road Management Act or the Environmental Protection Act, we will be enabling ourselves through those acts as opposed to duplicating those things through a local law as well. However, the clause that's been brought up about camping in the particular question is actually a provision that's exactly the same as our current local law. So that is something that's in our current local law. It's not a new provision, it's simply been duplicated with the new local law. And having that in our local law means that we can have a local law response to the issue. If we don't have it in our local law, these are already restrictions in place for that sort of thing called under acts, but it means that we then have to start compliance action under the Clean Environment Act or another act. So having that particular in our local law is actually much more efficient for us than having to undertake compliance under one of the other acts that we might have applied to. Perhaps that helps us explain.
Thank you. I'll pass the parcel. So I'll take questions from the floor. If members of the public have questions from the floor, would like to address council. Thank you, Mayor. I hope that's turned on for you.
I think I can arrange that. Is it on? It's on.
One of the concerns that the Community Association has had for a very long time is communication. We've talked about it so many times. And I've had an incident in the last week which indicated to me that communication is still not as good as it perhaps could be. I had occasion to want to book a Shire facility in Mount Beauty for...
Mary, just because of the video, could I ask you just to stand behind the lectern? Thank you.
Okay, going back a step, I had occasion last week to want to book a Shire facility in Mount Beauty. So I took the step that's been taken for years and years and years and went to the information centre, which has always been used as a resource for the Shire to do lots of their other business. I was told I couldn't book anything through them, I had to do it online. So I went home and I went online. I had difficulty finding the form in the first place. Having found the information, the facility I wanted wasn't even listed on the site, and that was the auditorium. I put the form in, I think, on Saturday morning, and I expected I might have got some response yesterday to at least say it's been received and we're looking at it. I've had none, so I sent an email to the Shire office today expressing what had just happened and asking what was wrong. And I got an email back to say it's been sent to the facilities department. Now, it seems to me a very long, convoluted way of getting a very simple task done. There is a computer link in the information centre in Mount Beauty. The girl could tell me it's not booked that day, but she couldn't actually take the booking. I just think it's very, very convoluted and awkward, and if you're expecting people to do everything online, you're going to cut a lot of people out. Not everybody yet is up to date with using computers and doing that sort of thing. You're going to cut out some people from actually being able to use the facility easily. I just wonder if the Shire could look into the organisation of that booking.
Thank you, Mary. I think Ms Cook is at her department, so all the CEO just a moment.
Mary, I'm sorry you had such a hard time trying to book the auditorium. We acknowledge we've got a few problems with a software solution in delivering our booking room, so we're looking at it at the moment. I don't know the specifics about why it kind of transpired the way it has, but I'm happy to take it away and try to track it down a bit and work out where it's broken down so we can get some more clear information. And while we're working through some of the challenges we have with bookings, I pray we can have a better process than that. So if you don't mind, I'll take it away.
What I can follow up, and I'll come back to you. Obviously, there has been a breakdown in communication on their side. So. Are there any further questions from the floor?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This report relates to the award of the December 2018 flood damage remediation works tender. In December 2018, a storm event caused damage to council assets across the Shire, with the most significant damage concentrated in the localities of Barwidgee, Gapstead, Mudgeegonga, Rosewhite and Dederan. The event has subsequently been declared eligible for funding under the Natural Disaster Financial Assistance Scheme, which is funded by the Federal Government and administered by the Victorian State Government. Council's team have identified 122 discrete items of flood-related damage to Council's road, bridge and drainage infrastructure. We've tendered for the engagement of a suitable civil contractor to undertake the remediation work. We've advertised in the newspapers, on Council's website and on the website tenders.net. We had a good response, so we had 24 prospective tenderers downloaded our documentation and 6 tender submissions were received. We've been through a comprehensive evaluation process. And through that process, we've determined that the tender from Stableman Enterprises best met the selection criteria. So our recommendation to Council is that Council awards a contract for the December 2018 flood damage remediation works to Stableman Enterprises based on the contracted schedule of rates that they provided with their tender.
Council Nicholas.
Nothing to add.
Mr. Pierce?
Nothing to add with my colleague.
Thank you. Any further comment? Take it to the vote. Oh, yes, sorry.
Only to say that we're going to get more and more of these
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This report provides the second quarterly report for 2018-2019 against the Alpine Shire Council plan, and the recommendations of the Council quarterly report is received and noted.
Thank you. Have a mover and a second, please. Councillor Nicholas. Councillor Rouse-Dyke. Councillor Nicholas.
Thank you very much for the report. I know we don't do the depth of reporting that we used to, but still fabulous to get the highlights. And I'd just like to point out one of them. My waste management is very close to my heart. And I wanted to pick out the successful Detox Your Home session in Brighton. I'm sorry, it is Bright Centre, this one. We used to hold those regularly, I was told, but they haven't been held for a while, and it's due to the passion and commitment and drive of Upper Shire staff that we need to hold them here again in Bright, and I just want to congratulate the staff. That's all I need to say.
Any further comment? Take it to the vote. All those in favour? Councillor Pinsky?
Thank you.
Thank you. Carry.
Fees and charges to fund its operations. Good revenue and debtor management practices are essential in enabling council's income to be collected effectively. The purpose of this report is to propose amendments to a policy, primarily to incorporate several other council policies, including the sale of occupied land for unpaid rates and charges policy, the application for financial hardship relief policy, and the debt write-off policy into one policy, which we are calling the revenue and debtor management policy. This forms part of a review that we're doing of all of our policies across council, and where we're trying to really simplify down the amount of policies we have and that they're up to date, that they are, and that they are compliant with current relevant legislation as well. So the policy itself is an attachment to the papers, Mr. Mayor, and the recommendation is that the council revokes those policies that are being superseded by this policy and adopts the Upon Shire Council revenue and debtor management policy, as well as signing and sealing it at the appropriate stage of this meeting.
So moved. Councillor Rover, seconded. Councillor Nicholas. Councillor Rover.
I'm all for consolidating our policies to make it easier for people to understand and for business and council to work. With this, for the efforts involved.
Councillor Nicholas? No. Definitely. Any further comment? No? Take the vote. All those in favour? Carried.
This report relates to the recent tender for the provision of banking and bill payment services. Council requires various such services to facilitate the receipt of income, the payment of suppliers, and the tracking management investment of our cash balances. A tender for the provision of banking and bill payment services was advertised in the Alpine Observer and the Melbourne Times on the 7th of November 2018, as well as on tenders.net and the Alpine Shire Council website. The tender documents were downloaded by 7 organisations, and 3 responses were received by the closing date. Key elements of the proposed contract include a term of 3 years with 2 options to extend to 12 months. Tenderers were invited to provide pricing for each required service, and estimated council volumes were provided to assist. The tender was prepared with the assistance of an experienced and independent banking tender consultant who also provided comprehensive analysis of the tender responses. So as you can imagine, this is quite a complicated tender process. The council recommendation is that council awards contract for the provision of banking and bill payment services to the Commonwealth Bank.
Thank you. Councillor Pearce. Seconded. Councillor Nicholas, thank you. Councillor Pearce.
It's a good idea. So, consolidate it all. Maybe the bank owes us some money though.
I am very happy with the awarding of this tender, but I just wanted to remind everybody that I'm really keen to see Hickling Nesting and that I'd like to keep that part of our judgment when we make decisions.
Thank you. Any further comments?
Thanks.
It is interesting to note that we've chosen the bank for Kenneth Hain. We have the big Kenneth Hain QC gave the biggest whack to. But it just goes to show that we actually, and the cost actually of the project is quite large, but we have to be sure that we do manage the council's funds appropriately.
Thank you. Councillor Pearson, you could say anything before. Take the vote. All those in favour? We didn't carry a note in the financial and resource implications, that is an estimated saving of $15,000 per annum by simply doing this process. It's not a simple process, I understand that, but there's a lot of work in it, but nevertheless, $15,000 savings. That's a long way to the toilet.
It is proposed to re-subdivide 5 existing lots to create 2 lots. A proposed lot 1 would have an area of 4 hectares, whereas the second proposed lot 2 would be 6.63 hectares and consolidate the remainder of the site for this, the subject of planning application. And the recommendation is that the notice of decision is given to grant a planning permit for a 2-lot re-subdivision in accordance with conditions outlined in attachment A, which forms part of the paper for tonight.
Thank you, Councillor Pearce. Councillor Nicholas. Councillor Pearce.
Thank you. I just want to say to the planning department that I like it when they work in a nice, sensible way like this, but they don't always. And I congratulate the Nikki and Daryl for their view and their vision on how to go about changing it around and making it fit. We had a lovely visit out there last week, and the whole plan was not just dreamt up or thought of for profit in future. It was a good balanced approach. Well done.
Nothing to add.
Thank you.
Further
comment?
Thank you for sharing this with us.
Thank you for that. Yes. All those in favour? Yes. And that Mr. Farmer is present. Recommendation summary of the Assembly of Councillors for November, December and January 2009 have been received. Councillor Nicholas, Councillor Epstein, all those in favour? Eric. Item 10, general business from our right.
Nothing still happened. We
we've got a report that says we should open a $2 million cafe. We've spent plenty of money, still no action. How long is this going to take? And a question for the Mayor and the CEO, what is going to happen?
Thank you, Councillor Rover, for bringing that to our attention. And we were very pleased with the report from PricewaterhouseCoopers. It was an extensive report that has been handed to government. We have been working with all the parties in relation to that. Fully acknowledge that it is not our building, it is not on our land, but our ratepayers had expected us to carry some of that burden to liaise with government on that, and we had a lot of talk, and I know it is just talk, you want results, and so we all want results in relation to the whole of Mount Buffalo and what's happening up there. And some of those things that were in the report are actually being done as we speak. So, what? I'll tell you.
So
Parks Victoria had already commenced putting solar panels on the roof of that building to assist with other forms of energy. Glamping has taken place in Lake Katani, and it has been extremely successful. We have had visiting politicians up there, and they are the ones that hold the purse strings. We don't hold the purse strings.
We still haven't got the chalet open, and that was what all this is about.
Yes.
We wanted the chalet open.
And I'm sure the government will be working toward that, and we will continue to work with government and interested groups to see if that can happen. We don't hold the purse strings. Unless you want to raise your rates, we can put $2 million up there.
I'm not interested in spending the council's money, but the council took on a job here recently at the behest of government for something to happen, something still hasn't happened, and the community wants to know when something's going to happen. So my message to you, Mr. Mayor, is from the community, is that we need to find out from this government in Victoria if and when they're going to do anything.
We have a meeting with the Minister for Local Government coming up in 16th of April. That matter will be raised with him, and if there is an opportunity to speak to the relevant minister or ministers and also the board of National Parks, of which he used to be a member of, and you know the ramifications of all of that and how the party politics works there, we will ensure that we have those conversations. I can't draw the money out of their pocket. So we can continue this conversation all night, but it's not going to get us anywhere. You've made your point simply that something needs to be happening there, and I think everybody in this room agrees absolutely entirely. We've done our very best as council, I believe, to do all the right things, but we can't take that step further. Do you have any further general business?
No.
Good. Councillor Nicholls? No. Councillor Hughes? No.
Okay.
Why not? It's
10 years.
Item 11. Motions for which notice of previous have been given. There are nil. Item 12. Reception and reading of petitions. There are nil. And item 13, documents for sealing, of which there are two. Councillor Napstein and Councillor Nicholls. Good. Thank you. All those in favour? Carried. There being no further business, I declare the meeting closed at 7:34 p.m. Thank you for coming. I'm glad it's still daylight. there might be an opportunity for those that want to have a quick look around a bit of this facility. That will, could we do that for some of the people that need a quick squeeze? That'll be good for those that wish. And we will convene at Mount Beauty next month.